the Weekly Show with David J. Maloney. This week, David talks to American Underdog producer Kevin Downs. And now, here's your host, David J. Maloney.
Welcome to everyone at home, and I would normally say our studio audience to the Weekly Show. I'm your host, David J. Maloney. I say normally because we'd usually shoot the show before a small studio audience at the Hard Rock Hotel and Casino, but we are still shooting from home due to coronavirus concerns. We hope to gain clearance and get back to our live-to-tape shows in the next few weeks. So, NASA has selected Huntsville, Alabama to lead development of the next lunar lander. This agreement was reached under one condition, that nobody paints Roll Tide on it. Although, when it does land on the moon, they can still yell touchdown. And a teenager in Florida was quickly captured by police after the car he tried to steal turned out to have a manual transmission. Well, at least in prison, we know he'll learn how to handle a stick. A recent study has revealed that one in five bosses will let you leave work early if you claim you have lady problems and then start crying. By the way, that works even better for guys. And it's been decided that boys will now be admitted to Scotland's last all-girl state school. They had better not make them wear skirts because that would look ridiculous, said a local Scotsman. Oh, and did you hear this? Scientists are saying that methamphetamine may be effective in treating influenza. They're calling it the nighttime sniffling, smoking, coughing, tweaking, rotten teeth, anger so you can rest medicine. Finally, the holidays are just around the corner, and I bought my wife an expensive belt and bag for Christmas. I honestly can't wait till she opens them. And with any luck, they'll finally make the vacuum cleaner work properly. On tonight's show, we chat with producer Kevin Downs about his fantastic new film releasing Christmas weekend, American Underdog. The film details the incredible true story of St. Louis Rams football legend Kurt Warner and his wife Brenda, starring Zachary Levi and Anna Paquin. You don't want to miss this film or this interview, so don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
Gave me something others didn't have. And I see that in you, Kurt.
Our featured guest tonight is an actor, writer, producer, and director. His newest film, American Underdog, details the incredibly inspirational and true story of St. Louis Rams legendary quarterback Kurt Warner and his wife Brenda. Here to talk about his personal journey and his fantastic new film, American Underdog, which will be hitting theaters Christmas weekend, is its producer, Kevin Downs. Kevin, welcome to the show.
Hey, good to be here, David. How are you?
I am doing dandy. So you grew up in California and not very far from the biggest movie-making area in the U.S. What was life like for you growing up in that area?
Well, I grew up about 3 hours north of Los Angeles in actually Central California, a very rural community, lots of farmland and animals and whatnot, and very different from Southern California as far as what it is today. But, I just had a love for movies and a love for TV shows and wanted to really just tell great stories, wanted to act. I mean, so I had my start in acting, and being able to act in Christian movies was something that was really impactful and insightful for me, because people really got, changed. Their lives were impacted by the stories that we were telling. And so when it comes around to American Underdog, Kurt Warner's story, I was a fan of Kurt while the story was playing out in real life. I'm a longtime Arizona Cardinals season ticket holder, about 18 years. So I've suffered through a lot, and although they're good this year, we'll see what happens. But anyway, when Kurt was playing for the Cardinals, I can just remember thinking, man, what a great story this is, just kind of unraveling, you know, from his days with the Rams and the NFL and his journey with Brenda and him, you know, bagging groceries in a supermarket and not being drafted. To all of a sudden, in a blink of an eye, basically, he's a Super Bowl winning quarterback and an MVP. And just, you know, what I loved about him was his transparency about his faith. He didn't hide about it. It was very front and center in his life. And you were able to kind of like adopt him as one of your own. I remember that succinctly. I mean, really when he was with the Giants, I was like praying that the Cardinals would actually sign him. And so when that opportunity came, oh my goodness, it was so exciting because I just was such a huge fan of who he is as a person, not just only as a player.
You know, I was so hard on you. Well, I put all that pressure on you. I had to know that you were ready. Had to be sure. And guess what? You are. I never would have put you on that field if I didn't fully believe you were a champion. And you get back out there and you get this job done. Let's go. Let's get after it.
Yes, sir.
And coach.
Thank you.
And the Rams are in business. A 34-yard return.
Hey, look at me. You can do this. I know you can.
Yeah, yeah. I got your back, no matter what happens. Let's go to work, man. Let's go to work.
All right. That last one was on me. But we got this. Let's get to work. Ride doubles, rip, 50 tail, on one, ready.
I remember that Super Bowl, and that the title of the movie is apropos because there were so many people who weren't necessarily fans of that team who had their team, you know, already not in the playoffs, weren't making it to the Super Bowl, who suddenly shifted to, you know, their I don't want to say loyalty, but they shifted, you know, their desire for who to win over to that team merely because of Kurt and his story and or his character.
Yeah, no, I mean, it was really fascinating because the Rams were coming out of a very downtrodden decade of futility, really. I mean, it was the reason why the owner kind of moved them out of Anaheim to St. Louis because they were just not a good football team, not a great franchise. And they had never really quite captured the spirit or just the energy that Kurt had as an individual. So he was just as much a gift to that franchise and that organization. And to be honest, to America, that he didn't know because he was so relatable to people. I mean, his story was just so relatable. I mean, it wasn't like he was handed, you know, he didn't have a silver spoon. It wasn't like he was handed this thing out of nowhere. He literally had to work for it. He had to earn it. He wasn't drafted. I mean, he literally went through everything that it was that it took for people to notice what his gift was. And how appropriate is that for us when we're kind of going through life and we just want people to notice us, to realize who we are and what our gift is. And oftentimes we kind of quit before it actually gets realized. But here's the story of Kurt. He didn't quit. He didn't give up. You know, his wife, Brenda, who had this incredible faith in God, you know, he saw that in her and that was an inspiration to him. And he, you know, has this moment in the movie, which was basically taken off of interviews of those two, where he says, I there's something about you that I want. I want what you have in my life. And that's what drives me forward and encourages me to not give up. And it was because of her encouragement and because of her belief that he shouldn't give up. You do have a gift and don't give up, that he actually persevered and conquered and became the quarterback and the man that he is today.
It tasted so well done. That
was a beautiful thing to watch.
Thank you. Thank you for believing
well done.
Coach. Thank you. Brenda! Hey,
baby! Hey, I don't know where we go from here. I don't know what comes next, but this, we did this. We did this together. I love you.
I love you, too. We did it.
That raises an interesting point, which is that, you know, there are times in which you see from a Christianity standpoint, people who are preaching with signs on the sidewalk or people that are out holding up Bibles and yelling. But then there are people who lead by example and you see what kind of peace or you see what kind of people they are and you want what they have. And so that's an interesting point that you raise, because in many cases, that's a story I hear over and over again when it comes to Christianity and people being born again or converting.
Yeah, I think it all goes back to the fruits of the Spirit, which are outlined in the Bible. And are we portraying love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, gentleness, self-control? And is that being exemplified in what our life is? And so often, you know, we'll go out, we'll see people kind of evangelizing kind of with a sledgehammer, but yet they're not portraying the fruits of the spirit, and they oftentimes don't see that, and yet we're most drawn into people that are like that, and you wonder why that is, right? But it's because God created it that way, and he's trying to communicate that to us through his word, and so the answer to me is right in front of us. And so when you see Kurt play out his story and play it out that way, where it's so relatable to who we are and we want to grab onto what it is that he has, it's because of that. I mean, he's not forceful, he's not bombastic with who he is as a person. He's very relatable, he's very humble, and it's elements like that that we want to kind of model our own life after.
What was the origin of basically your company's involvement with the project? I mean, how did you guys decide this was a story you wanted to tell? How did you end up with this story?
Well, yeah, as movie makers, you decide what movies you want to tell. So for us, John Irwin, Andy Irwin, and myself, we've been partners for 10 years. And so one of our films called I Can Only Imagine, when that one was released in theaters, we had an opportunity to tell a couple of stories. And so we picked a couple of stories that really were attractive to us. One of which was a movie called I Still Believe, that came out in theaters last year. Unfortunately, it came out March 13th, which was the day before theater shut down. And so very unfortunate situation. But another story that we came up with at that time was American Underdog. And it was the Kurt Warner story. And so we basically developed that story based on interviews that we did with Kurt and Brenda. And collectively, not just the three of us, but also in talking with them, we talked about what movie we wanted to make and what story of theirs we wanted to tell. And we decided, you know what, this is a story worth telling.
And when you mentioned meeting Kurt and Brenda for the first time, what was that experience like?
Well, for me as a fan of his, it was really surreal. I mean, I've got pictures of it because I'm like, oh my goodness, I just met Kurt Warner, so it was really quite amazing. But then the more I've gotten to know him through the movie making process, he's just a normal guy. He's an every man, like you or me, there's nothing necessarily overly different about him, other than the fact that he knows how to throw football good. So, which is something I can't do. I mean, I'm okay, I can throw a little bit, but I certainly can't do it at the level that he does.
Kevin, we got to go to a quick commercial break, pay the bills. Can you stick around to the flip side?
Yeah, look forward to it. Thanks.
Football. Tell me about that.
As long as I have a ball in my hands, I feel alive. Kind of like how I feel right now.
I'm staying here. I got work to do.
Work? The NFL's not going to draft some dude from the 1AA school in Iowa.
There were other offers.
I called every team in the NFL. No one's interested.
Can I get one of your applications?
I promised that I would take care of you and the kids. So that is exactly what I'm going to do.
If this is your dream, don't give up on it.
Football.
Yeah, they didn't pick me.
I pick you.
I pick you too.
Kurt Warner, you got the whole package, kid. The world just needs more time to see it.
He came up with this whole arena concept.
Arena football.
It's like a circus.
People love the circus.
I like the circus. Woo!
You pay me for a touchdown?
I also pay you to win.
Oh, this is going to be fun.
Hey, Kurt.
We've been trying to reach you.
I'm sorry, who are you?
I'm with the Rams.
This guy's old. Slow as molasses. He's beneath the standard of this franchise.
That's what people said about me when I came here.
All those years gave you something others didn't have. Made you ready for this moment.
Kurt Warner out of the Arena League. It's one of those stories that's too good for the movies. The
perfect guy here. He was bagging groceries 5 years ago.
Go out there and you show the world what I've known all along. You were born for this.
This is my time. I know who I am and I know why I'm here.
So how did you guys go about casting the movie, and what made you land on Zachary Levi and Anna Paquin?
Yeah, I mean, Zach Levi is an actor that all of us were very familiar with. Obviously, he plays the character, the title role of Shazam in that movie. There's another one coming out that they're making, but his entire body of work. So we were talking to Zach about doing another movie with us, and the script for American Underdog had come in, and Andy Irwin, the director of the film, was just communicating with Zach and was like, hey, dude, I don't know if you're interested in football, but you might want to read the script that we got. It's incredible. It's about Kurt Warner. And Zach knew who Kurt was. And so he read the script that night and texted Andy back. He's like, dude, we got to go make a football movie together. It's just that amazing. It's that undeniable. And so for me, I was like, you know what? Zach looks a lot like Kurt. So there was that element to it. And so I was like, okay, yeah, this could work. And they've got a lot of the same temperament, a lot of the same personality types. They're both full of energy. They both have this kind of unquenchable love for people. And it was like, this actually was really good. This really could work.
And the young kid who played Zach in the film, Hayden Zoller, did you guys feel like you struck gold when you found him?
Hayden was a true gift. I can't even believe we found him, to be honest. I mean, you know, when you have, when you're making a movie where one of the leading roles is this kid who is blind, that is like 10 years old or younger, actually, he was about 8, I think. You're like, how in the world are we going to do this? And so we auditioned some kids that weren't blind or whatnot. It just wasn't the same. And so when our casting director, who did a fantastic job in finding him, presented him to us, we were like, wow, you got to be kidding me. He is incredible. And so this was the first film that Hayden had ever done. Both of his parents are actors, but on set, I mean, you can see it in the movie. He's just got this natural gift about him, how he just seamlessly flows through the scenes in the film. And he is such a sweet kid. I mean, what you see is what you get with Hayden. And what was beautiful was it really was very similar to the real Zach. I mean, Zach Warner. The two of them were so much. They look alike, actually. Kurt and Brenda said. And we got a chance recently to be able to have the two of them meet each other for the first time, and that was really special. And so, how that happened, a really cute story is, they could hear each other, but they couldn't see each other. And so they met each other by feeling each other's face with their hands. And that's how they realized what the other one looked like. And it was so precious. It was so cute. But Hayden, what a gift. What a gift to this cast. Can't wait for people to see him.
So were there things or experiences that Kurt and Brenda went through that you guys wanted to fit into the film, but just simply didn't have enough room for? I mean, because their story does kind of read a little bit like a screenplay. So I got to presume there had to be.
Oh, there was a ton. I mean, there was a lot that we made really difficult decisions on. Some of which you'll see on the DVD. There's a lot of bonus content and scenes that we shot that didn't quite make the final cut. Of story, like just relationship stories with them that just didn't quite fit of what the narrative is that we were trying to tell. And so, their story is thick. It's very deep with stories. And when you make a movie, you've got to tell a segment. You can't tell the whole thing. You got to kind of tell a segment or a piece of a story because you only have like an hour and a half to 2 hours to tell it. And so it was tough to be able to cut some things out for sure.
Well, you mentioned some of your prior films before, and this movie, to me, had a slightly different flavor to the previous films. I mean, the faith narrative is ingrained seemingly deeper. Was that a conscious decision or just a natural part of telling Kurt and Brenda's story?
It was a natural part of telling the story. I mean, we wanted to be faithful and true to the story that Kurt and Brenda really were passionate about telling, because it was their life. It wasn't ours. So we didn't say, oh, well, this is what we think it should be. It was always about what we, you know, listening to them and hearing what they wanted to be told.
And it seems like there were so many beautiful moments in the film. Is there one that stands out to you? Maybe something that came off better on film than you all expected?
Yeah, I mean, one of the things that was really cool was, you know, we shot this in a pandemic where we really couldn't have extras. And so I think the most extras we had in a day was maybe 100, and that was one day. And so we weren't sure how this was going to look, because when you're shooting the football stuff, you've got to have 60,000 people in the stands cheering and make it not look fake and any of that stuff. And when it finally got put together, I mean, even Kurt said so. He goes, wow, the football in this looks absolutely stunning. And so the design John and Andy Irwin had, the directors of the film, you know, they really wanted to put the audience in the middle of the game, not necessarily have the camera angles from the TV angles up top, but really put the camera on the field so that the audience feels like what it's like to actually be in the game, so they could have Kurt's actual perspective from his point of view, which is very rare, I think, in football movies. And so it was, the reality of it was so, so spectacular. The visual effects turned out really spectacular. So it's something that I can't wait for people to see. The last 45 minutes of the movie makes you have this, even though you know what's going to happen, it's this rush of hope of what's going to happen, because you feel like you're a part of it all over again.
And I think you want to see that all over again. I mean, because it was such, I mean, like I said, for the people who became fans in the weeks leading up to the Super Bowl, it's just one of those things where you kind of want to, you know, enjoy that all over again. There's been countless football movies with kind of a spiritual story or undertone within them. I mean, as We Are Marshall, to your film Woodlawn, Remember the Titans. I mean, what is it about sports that seems to bring about those kinds of stories?
Well, sports is, I mean, you know, sports, not every sports story I think deserves to be told first and foremost, but there are stories that are sports related that are so incredible. And so it's when you see those extraordinary stories, whether it's in sports or something else, and that people overcome adversity and they overcome trials to be able to succeed. And in our case, you know, our design is we want to tell true stories that showcase the power of the gospel. And it just so happens that two of those have been sports related. So it's not like we desire to go make sports movies per se. But we want to showcase the power of the gospel in a true story. And it just so happens that sports is the underlying current. Now, for me, I love sports. I was an athlete in high school. So to be able to tell Kurt Warner's story is a dream come true, to be honest, because he's a person that I really admired when he was living his story out, just because he was so transparent with his faith.
So what is it that you would hope people take away from this film when it premieres Christmas weekend?
Yeah, I hope people are encouraged by this film. I mean, we're coming out of a time where, you know, many people haven't even been to a movie theater in a year and a half to 2 years. And I hope people will come together and gather together as a group, as a community, whether it's through your church, small group, or in your neighborhood or neighbors, and just watch a film that uplifts the human spirit. I mean, that's really what our goal was, to be able to tell this story in a time where people need their spirit to be lifted, to have this rush of hope that even though you're going through trials that are very significant, that there is hope at the end of it, and you should never give up. No matter what the trial is, just don't give up.
Kevin, thank you so much for joining us, and congratulations on a great film. Ladies and gentlemen, Kevin Downs.
Hey, thanks, David. Have a great day.
That's our show for tonight. Thank you so much for watching. A special thanks to Kevin Downs for joining us. Next week, we have the lead singer of Kansas, Ronnie Platt, on the show. So you won't want to miss it. Stay safe, everyone.